फ्रेंड्स, गुड मॉर्निंग, वेल्कम बैक। माई सर पुष्पेंद्र सिंह एंड वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद अवर डेली करंट अफेयर्स। सो टुडे यू हैव 11th May 2021, ऑल राइट, एंड दिस क्लासेस आर बेसिकली बेस्ड ऑन द डेली करंट अफेयर्स। सो फॉर दैट यू शुड बी स्टडीइंग द नेशनल न्यूज पेपर्स लाइक द हिंदू और इंडियन एक्सप्रेस। बोथ ऑफ दीज न्यूज पेपर्स आर इक्वली गुड। You can refer any of these newspapers. Apart from that, you can also refer any of the current affairs magazine. Okay, that will also be useful, and you can supplement your preparation with the help of these lectures. The lectures are uploaded on the YouTube on the day-to-day basis, so you can refer and you can subscribe these lectures on the YouTube. All right, so let's begin with the lecture. So the first news is related to the digital financial inclusion. What is digital financial inclusion? The financial inclusion is the process, as you know, that through which the all of those people who are not being financially connected, or those are not in the financial system of the government of the particular country, have been now been connected through digitally. So that is, that process is called basically digital financial inclusion. So now, in order to enhance the pace for the digital financial inclusion in the country, right, a digital inclusive Bharat, to make basically a digital inclusive Bharat, or to connect every section of the society, right, every people in the country, right, digitally in terms of the financial inclusion, right, the Niti Aayog and the MasterCard released a report that titled that the connected commerce, creating a roadmap for digital inclusive Bharat. This basically report, which is given by the Niti Aayog and the MasterCard, right, that basically identified certain challenges. These challenges are basically comes in the way of this financial inclusion of the people, right? So it provides certain recommendations so that we could make the 1.3 billion citizens digital, accessible to the, to the financial services, right? So that makes the digital services accessible to 1.3 billion citizens of the country. Okay. Now, regarding Niti Aayog, you know that Niti Aayog is basically a public policy think tank which belongs to the government of India. Right, it was established to achieve the sustainable development goals, definitely with the help of the cooperative federalism. How would you achieve that? By fostering the involvement of the state governments of India in the economic policy making process. So that is what we call it as a cooperative federalism, right? So the Niti Aayog is basically using the bottom up approach for that purpose. Regarding MasterCard, the MasterCard is basically incorporated as an American multinational financial services corporation, right? This is basically, and you can say that it is a basically international global, financial services corporation, which is basically involved in some sort of operations, right, related to the financial services. Now, it basically involved in payments, technology, right, as well as all sort of services which will be provided to the consumers, to the businesses, to the merchants, as well as the governments around the world. Okay, certain key recommendations of this report, which was given by the Niti Aayog as well as the MasterCard, that both of them has recommended that the payment infrastructure, right, should be strengthened, right? That means we should upgrade our payment infrastructure in order to make, right, the level playing field between the NBFCs and the banks, right? So the payment infrastructure, which is basically not as per the standard, that should be strengthened, right, or that should be upgraded. And the report further says that there should be, right, the more compliance related to the regulations and the rules, right? The report also says that there should be registration digitally for that purpose, right? And there should be enough opportunities that should be available for the MSMEs, that is micro, small and the medium industries, so that they could also develop. For that purpose, we need the diversifying credit sources, and the diversifying credit sources would be available if such type of compliance and the registration should be done on the digital platform. Okay, then the report further says that we should also adopt certain set of the information sharing system, right? For example, for the protection of the consumers or to alerting the consumers specifically related to the fraud. So the report further says that there should be some fraud repository. That fraud repository basically deals with, you know, certain set of information to the customers or to the consumers that would provide them a warning. That would provide them a warning so that they could alert. They could alert, right, during such fraud type of things. Okay. Now the report further says that the agricultural NBFCs or non-banking financing companies, right, they should have access to the low-cost capital so that they could be able to sustain this process of the NBFCs, and these NBFCs should be able to deploy the phygital means, you know, some sort of a physical plus digital mode, right, for development, for basically the digital outcomes, right, as well as to provide, you know, some sort of a services to the sector. Okay. And to make, you know, these all services seamlessly available to all, right, you know, the report further says that we should be able to leverage smartphones, right, these contactless cards, right, so that we could be able to make the system interoperable, fully open system, just like in London Tube, which I've done in the case of UK. Okay. Now, the thing that is coming to your mind is, what is NBFC? See, NBFCs is basically the non-banking financial company. It is basically registered under the Company Register Act 1956. The main purpose of the NBFC is basically engaging in the business of the loans, advances, acquisition of the shares or the stocks, or you can say bonds, debentures, and the securities, definitely which are issued by the government of India or the local authority. Okay. And they are also involved in some sort of a marketable security like leasing, hire, purchasing, insurance business, chip businesses, and also, and etc. Okay. So you can say that a non-banking financial company, it is a non-banking institution, okay, which is basically the principal business of receiving the deposits, right, under any scheme, right, and they have some sort of a, you know, the non-banking type of company, which is basically does not have that full banking, you know, the facilities, which is lying with the banks. Okay. Next. The Mount Sinabung is basically located in the Indonesia, specifically in the Sumatra province of Indonesia. Okay. Now, this Mount Sinabung, which was, you know, active since 2010, now has erupted, right, and it is a volcanic mountain. It has erupted and it has basically caused, you know, some sort of volcanic smoke and volcanic ash, which have scattered in the sky up to 3000 meters high. Okay, so this has basically caused some sort of uneasiness, specifically in the Sumatra province of Indonesia. Okay, now this, you know, the volcanic eruption is basically after 400 years of the inactivity. You could think of that it was active since 2010 and it is finally, you know, erupted in that process. Okay. Now, as you know that Indonesia basically, you know, also falls under, you know, rings of the fire, which is basically a circumpacific belt where you have the active belt of volcanoes or volcanic activities and earthquakes, right? It is basically also falls in the area of the Pacific Ocean, which is characterized by these active volcanoes, you know, very frequent earthquake that also comes in those circumpacific belt. Okay. So if you want to know more about it, it is, you can say that it is basically the home of around 75% of the world earthquakes, right? More than 75% of the world earthquakes as well as the volcanoes, right? That occurs throughout the world. Okay, as you know that Indonesia is basically, you know, Republic of Indonesia, which is a country in Southeast Asia. Okay, and it falls between Indian Ocean as well as the Pacific Ocean. Okay, and it has around 17,000 islands, right? The major islands which falls in the Indonesia are Sumatra, Java, Sulawesi, Borneo, New Guinea, etc. Okay, the capital is Jakarta. Regarding Ring of Fire, or you know, the Circumpacific Belt, right? This Ring of Fire or Circumpacific Belt is basically, you know, it's a rim that basically, you know, surround your volcanic ocean, right? Where almost 75% of the world volcanoes and more than 90% of the world earthquakes basically occur. So it is basically the horse-shaped belt of around 40,000 kilometers long, right? And it is around 500 kilometers wide, where you will have this 75% of the world volcanoes and 90% of the earthquake that basically occurs. Okay, so here you will have the Mount Cinnabon, which is basically having, you know, recently been erupted and which has caused the huge volcanic ash, and you know, basically which has gone up to 3000 meter or 3 kilometers up in the sky. Okay, next, the lineament, right? Or lineament. What is this lineament? You can say that it is basically, you know, it's a linear fracture, right, in the landscape. You can say that this linear fracture in the landscape is something which is associated with a fault or geological structure, okay, which is also responsible for the coming of the earthquake, specifically in the Sonitpur area of the Assam. As you know that the Assam basically falls in the northeastern region of our country. Now this also comes under the zone 5, right? When you classify, you know, the seismically active zone, so it is a basically, you know, very seismically high, you know, active zone, and Assam basically falls in that zone. It's already under very high seismically, you know, prone zone, and it has been recorded or it has been categorized as a zone 5 for that purpose. And this linear fracture is basically responsible for the earthquakes which have recently been occurred in the Sonitpur area of Assam. So according to the Geological Survey of India, right, this Sonitpur district lies basically in the triangular, you know, the complex tectonically area, right, which is basically a triangular in the shape, right, and it has been, you know, basically, you know, bounded by the three faults, that is the Athyarkat fault, then it is basically the Kopili fault, and basically your north-south trending lineament. This basically all led to this complex triangular, you know, the area which is basically responsible for these type of earthquakes which are falling in this area. Okay, as you know about the lineament, as I told you that it is a linear fracture, right, in the landscape, and it is basically an expression of the geological structure of the particular area. Okay, and normally this lineament basically appears as a fault aligned valley, or you can say that it may have, you know, a series of the fault, or you may have the fold aligned hills, right, or you may have the combination of either of these, right, that has basically caused certain tectonic activities in this zone. Okay, now as I told you that this is basically comes, you know, as a complex triangular area which is bounded by these faults, right, all around the three sides of this triangular area. Okay, now these two faults that we are talking and the lineament, right, these two fault and the lineament, that is basically your the Athyarkat fault, right, then Kopili fault, and this north-south trending lineament, this basically bound your, you know, your the three sides of this triangular area. Okay, now we are talking about these two fault, that is I told you that that is basically your Athyarkat fault and basically your Kopili fault, and your linear alignment, that is basically in the north-south direction, right, have led to the oblique of convergence, right, and this oblique convergence occurs of the Indian plate that caused this, you know, your frequent earthquake specifically in this region, in this region. Now you would be thinking, what is this oblique, you know, convergence? So the oblique convergence is basically something which is related to the convergent boundary. Convergent boundary means the bend of both of the two plates, basically they are moving towards each other. So such convergence basically produces some sort of a asymmetric deformation or asymmetric topography or some sort of a asymmetric collision boundary. So right, so this type of, you know, the convergence, this type of convergent margin, or this type of, you know, your oblique convergence basically having the angle of subduction which is oblique. So angle of subduction, which is a oblique, and which basically resulted into some sort of a strain into the arc, right? And that basically causes some sort of a strain in this, you know, in this whole axis. And this occurs as a response of the shear stress that is basically occur perpendicular to the plate margin, and that has ultimately led to the fracture and the hewn energy basically accumulated over the period of the time. And the sudden release of the energy basically causes your earthquake at that point of the time. Okay, so as per the National Center of the Seismology, right, they have recorded around 29 earthquakes, right, which is having the magnitudes from varying 2.6 to 4.7, right. And recently on the April 28th, you have 6.4 magnitude of the earthquake that has been occurred. And after that, there were lot of aftershocks also between 2.6 to 4.7 magnitude, right? And that has already damaged several buildings, bridges, and river embankments also. As I told you that the northeastern zone comes under the seismic zone 5. So it is basically very high seismic zone or seismic, very high seismic prone zone. Okay. As you know that there is, you know, the Himalayan region specifically, or Himalayan belt basically is formed out of the collision between the Indian plate and Eurasian plate, right? So there was some sort of a collision between these two plates. This oblique collision is basically responsible for the stress accumulation specifically in this zone. So you have, as I told you that you have basically, you know, some sort of a triangular area or tectonically triangular area, which is basically formed out of this Athercat fault and Kopili fault, as well as your north-south trending, you know, your lineament, which is basically responsible for basically, you know, this type of earthquake specifically in this region, right? This is very, very important. Okay, so here you will have this map basically belongs to the Geological Survey of India. Okay, next, South Sudan. See, South Sudan is basically a country which has recently become independent in 2011, right? After, you know, a deadly civil war. Now, what happens is the South Sudan, which was recently become independent in 2011, right? Now, you must understand there is still lot of clashes and the violences specifically in this region. Now what happens is the current president of the South Sudan, Mr. Salva Kiir, has dissolved the parliament. Now what happens is once the parliament is dissolved, what will happen? There would be the elections. Definitely there will be elections, and the lawmakers that, you know, there is a fight first of all for the power capture, for gaining maximum amount of the power, specifically in the South Sudan, right, administrative setup. So there are two factions, right? One is belong to, you know, the Salva Kiir, right, and another is basically belong to the Vice President Riek Machar, right? So both have already signed an accord in 2018, right, for the purpose of the power sharing, right? And that is basically against, you know, some sort of a the civil war which was ruined the country, right, and has killed almost 4 lakh people specifically in the South Sudan, and more than 4 million people were displaced in this civil war. So in order to stop that one, right, accord was signed, and this legislative assembly was basically part of that accord, which was some power sharing agreement between the president Mr. Kiir as well as the vice president Mr. Machar. Okay, this is some background. Now, this legislative assembly or the parliament has now been dissolved. Now, that will be, you know, that would pave the way for, you know, from, you know, opposing sides that can come together and for the purpose of the lawmakers. Now, let us understand this accord, or let us understand a brief background. So, first of all, the accord which was signed between Kiir and Mr. Machar, right? This was basically has led to that there will be 550 lawmakers, and among the 550 lawmakers, around 332 belongs to, you know, the faction. 332 belongs to the faction, which is basically led to Mr. Kiir, the SPLM party, the SPLM party. All right. Now, you must understand that, as I told you, that South Sudan basically gained independence from Sudan. Right? Sudan was basically a country, or still a country. The South Sudan basically emerged as a new country, right, or as an independent country in 2011, precisely 9 July 2011. Right? This was an outcome of 2005 agreement that was, you know, that was related to this civil war. So this 2005 agreement basically ended the Africa's longest running civil war. Now, as I told you that the South Sudan is one of the most diverse countries in the world. Right, there are more than 60 major ethnic groups, and majority of these people basically follow the traditional religions. Now, there is a tussle between these diverse sections of the society in the South Sudan. Okay, so independence in 2011, you know, did not bring peace among these people. So what happens is, in 2013, you know, a civil war basically broke out, and the president basically, as well as the vice president, right, both have, you know, have some sort of a conflict, and what happens is that has led to the displacement of 4 million people, and the power sharing agreement was signed between the parties, right, in order to stop this civil war in August 2018. Okay, and these parliamentarians, which were nominated by the different parties, there was no such direct election, but there was nomination for that purpose of, you know, basically your election, for the purpose of this parliament. Now, this party, which is known as SPLM party, that is also known as Sudan People's Liberation Movement Party, or Sudan People's Liberation Movement Party. It is a political party in South Sudan. Okay, it was founded as a political wing of Sudan People's Liberation Army in 1983. Okay. And what was happening in 2005, as I told you, that there was some agreement to end the civil war, right? So, you know, a comprehensive peace agreement was signed between this party, SPLM, that is Sudan People's Liberation Movement, as well as, you know, your SPLA, that is basically your Sudan People's Liberation Army, as well as the government of Sudan. Right, government of Sudan, and that has ultimately led to some sort of a relief in the civil war in the South Sudan. Okay, so here you can see the South Sudan, which has recently been emerged in 2011. The capital is Juba, right? So this is the political map. You can easily see that the members or neighboring members, Uganda, Kenya, Ethiopia, Democratic Republic of Congo, right? Like CAIR, Chad, Sudan, these are all the political entities which are lying, you know, that just into the South Sudan. Fine. Next, S. Janaki Raman Advisory Group, right? So here what happens is, as you know, that the Reserve Bank of India has set up this advisory group, right? This advisory group, which was set up, is also known as, right, you know, basically, you know, Second Advisory Review Authority. This advisory group, you know, which have been constituted, right, to assist this regulatory review authority, which was also set up by the Reserve Bank of India, right, by the central bank earlier this month. And the purpose of setting up of this advisory group, or, you know, to assist your regulatory review authority, to basically reduce some sort of a compliance burden over the regulatory entities or regulated entities. So here, you know, SBI Managing Director S. Jani Raman, right, who will be basically, you know, having the group will assist the Regulatory Review Authority, right, which was set up by the Reserve Bank of India. The main purpose of setting up this Regulatory Review Authority is to streamline the regulations, guidelines, right, that are basically should be rationalized over the period of the time. So here, the group which is led by as, you know, Janaki Raman, but basically, you know, assist this regulatory review authority, right, in identifying certain areas which is related to the regulations, guidelines, and the returns, right, and which should be rationalized over the period of the time, right, as the recommendations would definitely follow, and that will be, you know, help in terms of rationalization of those guidelines. Now, This regulatory review authority was also set up in 1999 by the Reserve Bank of India. And this regulatory review authority that was set up, the main purpose was basically to rationalize those regulations, circulars, right, the reporting systems, right, that should be, you know, based on some sort of a feedback from the public, banks and the financial institutions. Then the second regulatory review authority which was set up, right, for the period of 1 year, right, from May 1st, 2021, right, the main purpose again to reduce the compliance burden of the regulated entities, right, and the Reserve Bank of India Deputy Governor M. Rajeshwar Rao was basically appointed as a, you know, the regulations review authority, right, to, for the purpose of this rationalization, for the purpose of reduction of this burden of the compliance specifically on those entities. Okay, next, your PGEDA. Now let us understand first what is PGEDA. See, PGEDA is basically, you know, is the name, that is a short name for the Patriotic Europeans Against Islamism, Islamization of Occident, right? That is basically, you know, abbreviated as the PGEDA. So what is PGEDA? In short, you can understand that it is a social movement. It is a social movement. Okay. And, you know, the main purpose is basically some sort of a, you know, the anti-Islam movement, which was basically arises in the Europe, specifically in the Germany, right? So it basically consists of the patriotic Europeans against the Islamization of the West. Okay, now it is originated specifically in the Eastern Germany city of, you know, Dresden in 2014. Okay, and as you know that during that point of the time, there was lot of, you know, the refugee crisis. And the Germany Chancellor, Miss Angela Merkel, was open for the refugees, specifically for giving them a, you know, asylum in the Germany. And the people basically started opposing, specifically in the context of the Islamization of the West. They were susceptible that these Muslim people may cause certain erosion to their, you know, to their civilization, right? So it is a anti-Islamic movement that was originated in the Eastern Germany. Okay, and these people, which belongs to the PGEDA, these people basically staged several rallies in the several cities of across the Europe against their opposition, right, you know, for the government move of giving asylum specifically to the Muslim refugees, right, specifically from the Middle East and Africa. So here the German intelligence services has said that, right, that they would widen the surveillance of Islamophobia protest movement that is known as the PGEDA. As I known you that PGEDA is basically some sort of a, a movement which stands for the Patriotic Europeans Against the Islamization of the World. So it is a some sort of Islamophobic protest movement which is running out in the Europe, specifically in the Germany, right, in the state of Saxony. Saxony is basically the state, is a state in the Eastern Germany, right? And here some extremists as well as the anti-constitutional people basically have come out to support this movement. Okay, so the PGEDA was basically initially attracted heterogeneous, you know, support. That means from every section of the society basically supported them, and they have taken the moderate position. That means they have not taken the extreme position specifically in the initial phase of the time, but now over the period of the time it has developed the right-wing extremism orientation. That means they have taken the extremist activities also, right? That has been recently been informed by the domestic intelligence agency LFV of the Saxony state of Germany. Okay, right, the PGEDA, which is basically aimed at the campaign against the Islamization of the West, that was started in 2014, right? And there was marches in almost every cities, right, in this Germany. Okay, and that gained momentum during the refugee crisis in 2015, when the Chancellor Angela Merkel basically allowed the Muslim refugees, specifically from the Middle East and Africa, to come to take the asylums, specifically in the Germany. So to keep the country's door open to the asylum seekers, this movement further gained strength.
Okay.
So here you could see the persons who are protesting, right, against the policies of Angela Merkel, who were allowing the asylum seekers from the Middle East, from the West, right, specifically for the purpose of asylum.
Okay.
Next, the Roopsi Airport. Now you know, understand, the Roopsi Airport was basically built in 1939, right? It was built for the purpose of, you know, the World War II, right, for the purpose of supplying of the manpower, ammunition in the Burma or in the Myanmar and the China, specifically during the World War II. Okay, so this is the time when this Roopsi Airport was basically built, and this airport was basically built in the Assam Dhubri district. So it is basically the oldest airport you could think of, right, in terms of its operational readiness for the purpose of the defense. Okay. So it is an airport which is located near Gauripur, which is around 15 kilometers away from the district headquarters in the Dhubri, right, which is in Asia's, you know, South Asia's largest airport. And it is having, you know, one of the longest runways of around 1.8 kilometers long, right. And it was used by the Allied aircraft for the purpose of supplying of these manpower, ammunition, specifically during World War II. And it is basically the Assam's 7th airport, and it is a 15th northeastern airport, right? And the commercial flights later allowed after, you know, this arm, manpower, ammunition which was supplied during World War II. Okay. And as you know that India's partition happens in 1947, that has basically eroded some sort of importance which was given to this Roopsi airport. Now, this airport was ultimately abandoned after the last flight which was took off from Dhubri to the Guwahati in 1983. Okay, that was known as a Vayudoot. Okay, now, Indore-based company known as Flybig, right, now would be permitted to take the flight specifically from Kolkata to Guwahati, right, and Roopsi, that is the flight route from Kolkata to Guwahati to Roopsi, then from Roopsi to Guwahati to Kolkata, right. Indore based company called Flybig would be operating the aircraft under the Udaan scheme for the purpose of the regional connectivity, right. So you must understand that this airport called Roopsi is very, very vital for the India's strategic purpose, for the security purpose, as well as for the Western Assam, for the development of Assam, for example, right, it will cater to the needs of the people, specifically in the Meghalaya, the Koch Bihar, the West Bengal, Bhutan, right, it will also scale up the production, specifically in the small scale industries. Okay, now as you know that Udaan that I was talking about, the Udaan scheme is basically, that is Ude Desh Ka Aam Nagrik, right, it is a regional connectivity scheme which was started by the government of India, right. The main purpose is to develop the smaller regional airports to allow the common citizens easier access to the aviation services in the country. Okay, so under this Udaan, the Flybig, which is an Indore based company, has given, you know, the operating the license for the purpose of operation of the flight from Kolkata to Guwahati to Roopsi under this Udaan scheme. Okay, next, socially and educationally backward classes. Now you must understand, these socially and educationally backward classes, they are also sometimes known as other backward classes. Now Supreme Court has recently said that only center is empowered to identify who belongs to or who is basically the socially and educationally backward classes, and that will also, you know, the central government will alone, you know, include them in the central list to claim for the reservation purpose. For example, 27% reservation is being accorded. So the Supreme Court very categorically says that the central government alone, right, will have the power, right, that who are the economically and socially backward classes, right, and they will be able to, you know, list down, right, under Article 342A Clause 1, and that should be deemed for the purpose of, you know, the inclusion of this socially and educationally backward classes to every state and the union territory for the purpose of the constitution. So state government, the central government is empowered to disclose and to identify those caste. As you know that the Indian constitution basically described the socially and educationally backward classes, right, which are also known as OBCs or the other backward classes. And government of India is basically have given, you know, some sort of a the reservation, that is 27% reservation in the public sector employment as well as the higher higher education. Okay, the states could only make suggestions, right, but ultimately that would be incorporated, right, you know, by the center. So the states will be making the suggestions to the president, right, and they could make also the suggestions to the statutory commissions, like you have the backward class commissions for the purpose of inclusion or exclusion or modification of the caste in the which is included in the list. And the Supreme Court very categorically says that the center list is the only list for the basically socio and educationally backward classes. So under Article 342, right, only the parliament has power to amend that list. Only the parliament can amend that list. That means the parliament can change, the parliament can alter, parliament can remove or add any of these caste into the socio and educationally backward class under Article 342A clause 2. Okay, and the task for identification of this socio and educationally backward classes, right, the president that is basically, you know, empowered for the purpose of that one is to be guided by the commission that is known as the National Commission for the Backward Classes. Right, this National Commission for the Backward Classes have been recently been given a constitutional status under Article 338B, right, and you know, it should also advise, you know, from time to time, right, and the advice shall also be sought by the state in this regard for the purpose of identifying those socio and educational backward classes. Okay, and this National Commission for the Backward Classes basically prepares a report concerning the matter of identification, that who should be included in the list, and that report should also be shared with the state, right, and that will be done in accordance with Article 338 clause B. Okay, now the final determination or final decision regarding the exercise will be taken by the president, that means by the central government under Article 342A clause 1. Okay, and this power of the president of final determination and any sort of a modification the list by the parliament, right, does not stop the state from being giving reservation in favor of a particular community or the caste within ambit of Article 15 and Article 16 of the constitution of our country. Okay, next you have the Empotericin B. The Empotericin B is basically an injection. Okay, it is an injection which is to be given for the treatment of the life-threatening fungal disease. Okay, so this injection is basically used for the purpose of the treatment of this fungal disease. So you must understand this Empotericin is in the shortage. So acute shortage of this antifungal injection that is called Empotericin has caused huge, hue and cry, specifically among the medical sector. So this antifungal medicines, which basically used to treat that mucormycosis, which is basically a type of fungal disease, a life-threatening fungal infection, right, that is also caused a worry, specifically the COVID-19 patients. Okay, now which also adds the difficulties of the patients specifically, which are basically infected with the COVID-19 pandemic. Okay, so this Empotericin B injection is basically used for the purpose of the treatment of this life-threatening fungal infection that is known as the mucormycosis. Okay, then here the Empotericin B injection is basically, you know, a type of injection which is also, you know, given at the time of this antifungal infections, right, and it is given by the injection directly into the vein of the patient. The Empotericin B was basically isolated from the Streptomyces nodosis in 1955, and it was started in the medicinal use in 1958 onward. Okay, and the World Health Organization have already, you know, involved or already noted this Empotericin B as the list of essential medicines that could be used for the purpose of the treatment of this, you know, this mucormycosis, right, which is a fungal disease. So this mucormycosis is basically, which are serious but rare fungal infection which was caused by the group of mold, or you can say that these molds are also sometimes known as the mucormycetes. Okay, these molds live throughout the environment. Okay, and they mainly affect the people who have health, some sort of a health problems, right, and who takes the medicines and who are basically, you know, are having, you know, lesser ability to fight the germs and the sicknesses, right? Okay, so here you could see that the mucormycosis, which is a rare fungal disease which basically affected the patients. So as you know that second wave of COVID-19 pandemic is ravaging the country, the mucormycosis, which is a rare life-threatening disease or infection, is reported among the COVID-19 patients, is also the second cause of worry. Okay, next you have the Sinopharm. Sinopharm is basically a vaccine candidate, belongs to China. Recently, the World Health Organization has approved the Sinopharm, which is a vaccine or COVID-19 vaccine candidate for the emergency use. Okay, so it has got the WHO green light. So UN Health Agency, WHO or World Health Organization has signed off this two-dose vaccine. That means the vaccine which will be administered to the people, right, in the two-dose format. Okay, and this has already been deployed in the dozens of the countries around the world. Okay, and as you know that WHO has already given the green light to various vaccine candidates. For example, you have, you know, the vaccines which are made by the Pfizer Biotech, then Moderna, J&J, AstraZeneca, Jeff, right? And some of these vaccines are also produced in India and the South Korea also. Okay, now you must understand how these vaccines basically work. So this vaccine, some of these vaccines are basically both based on some sort of a, some sort of an inactivated coronavirus vaccine. So this inactivated coronavirus vaccine, which is also the classic example, is Sinopharm vaccine, right? And you have the Covaxin. The Covaxin, which is developed by the Bharat Biotech India, right, is also the inactivated coronavirus vaccine. Okay, now this inactivated vaccine basically takes the disease carrying virus, that is the SARS-CoV-2, right, and it kill it, and during heat, chemicals or radiation. So this inactivated vaccine, which is basically, is a one form of the vaccine, which is basically is currently in the use for the purpose of the treatment of, for the purpose of reducing this infections from the SARS-CoV-2 virus, right? So here you could think that this is the first way to make the vaccine, to make the disease carrying virus or the bacterium, or one very similar to it, or simply you can say that it inactivate or kill it using chemicals, heat or radiation. This approach, which uses the technology, right, that has proven to work in the people, right, and previously the polio vaccines and the flu vaccine have already been used, this inactivated form of the virus, right, and these vaccines can be manufactured on the reasonable scale. Okay, but you need for the purpose specialized laboratory facilities to grow the virus or these bacterium safely, right? And it can have, some sort of a relatively long production time, and it may require the 2 to 3 dose that may be administered, right, over the period of the time, right, before the final outcome can be seen in the people. Okay, the WHO also noted that these vaccines take the longer time to make and might need 2 to 3 doses to be administered, that I told you. The flu and the polio vaccines have already been used this approach that I've already informed you, right? And out of these major vaccines which are already in the use, the Sinopharm Covaxin, which is also used in India, the Sinovac, which is also belongs to the China, have already used this inactivated virus process for the purpose of developing of these vaccines. There are another way where we could also develop the vaccines, like you have the mRNA vaccines, right, where you have the Pfizer, BioNTech and Moderna were basically using this method of development of the vaccines, right, where the Oxford's AstraZeneca, Sputnik, right, Johnson & Johnson's single dose vaccines are basically used through this mRNA process, right? So what is this mRNA process? This mRNA process, sometimes it is also known as the genetic approach or nucleic acid vaccine. So what is this genetic approach? So unlike the other vaccine approach that we have seen, you know, in terms of your, the Sinovac or Sinopharm, that is inactivated virus form. So this genetic approach or this mRNA vaccine would basically, use either the weakened or the dead whole microbe or the part of one, right? That is a nucleic acid vaccine, right? Just like a secretion of the genetic material, you could think of that could provide, you know, instructions to the specific protein and not the whole microbe. So this DNA and the RNA are basically, they are the instructions our cells basically use to make the protein. Okay, now in our cells, the DNA is, the first to turn into the messenger RNA, right? That is also known as sometimes mRNA, and which is then used as a blueprint to make the specific protein. So this nucleic acid, the vaccine delivers a specific set of instructions to our cells, right? Either as a DNA or mRNA, right? And then for them to make a specific protein that we want in our immune system. You are getting my point? To recognize and to respond ultimately to that particular thing. And this nucleic acid approach or this genetic approach is the new way of delivering, the developing vaccines. As you know that this COVID-19 pandemic, right, this has basically necessitated this the fast approval for those vaccines, specifically for the purpose of the uses in among the humans, right? And this pandemic has, used basically this opportunity for the purpose of the development of this mRNA vaccines, right? For the emergency use authorizations, right? Now they have given the people specifically, right? During that phase also. All right. So that's all for today. Thank you very much. We will meet tomorrow for our next current affairs. Thank you.